also, MAPSA, the Mexican American Community Service Agency, was just awesome because I was a Work City student there for 4 years, and other colleagues at all. And of those colleagues, I know at least 5 who became teachers or school administrators. Pancha, Francis Martinez became a VP at Silver Creek High School and other schools, high schools in the area. Anyway, just different people, and we're so proud of them because they, you know, it was as a result of, as Carl said, our activism. It was, we didn't just sit back. We got out of the classrooms. We started programs for our children who weren't reading, you know, and other things.
There was a teatro there of San Jose State students that spread. Of course, Luis Valdez learned his skills or honed his skills there while he was a student. And the world was forever changed with El Teatro Campesino, but there was other local, El Teatro de la Gente and others that and groups such as Florida del Pueblo, which I might add that we also have one of the musicians here, Francisco Rodriguez, and others as well
yes.
that are featured, that are part of this incredible...
And a professor
as well.
Yeah. Yolanda's dad.
Yolanda...
Pérez,
that's
Ramiro,
right. Ramiro.
And he's a musician and a professor at the state.
So what can you share with us as well about the teatro, the cultura, the muralists, the whole, all of that part of the culture?
Very much so. It was a way for us to better understand our culture and our place in the local community and in the world at large. But even more so, if you looked at the Centro Cultural de la Gente and Teatro de la Gente, Adrian Vargas was instrumental in doing that, and he's, to me, a true hero that sacrificed so much to make sure that would all happen. But even beyond that, you had Rudy Madrid with his music, mm-hmm. and in many ways, to me, all that was wonderful because it was like, if I look back, I saw a program in World War II, Bob Hope had entertained the troops overseas for the USO. So for me, in many ways, the Centro Cultural de la Gente and Rudy Madrid was like our USO. It's what kept us motivated. It was a way for us to relax and get away from the pressures of being out protesting and going to school. So in that sense, it was very helpful and beneficial to us. It motivated us. It allowed us to better understand our role in society. So it's sort of a very useful function, I feel.
Yeah, one of the things I like to do a little spin-off on that, most of us, at least I can speak for myself, when we went to high school and elementary school, we listened to Mexican music at home, pura rancheras, you know, and then we'd go to school and listen to the oldies in English. I mean, we were so excited when La Bamba came out because it was the first, you know, song that was in Spanish, La Bamba. And so when we get to San Jose State, we get to, and then a lot of us, like myself, would go to the tardeadas, mm-hmm. you know, the dances, and they had cumbias and cha-cha and all that. And so we loved it, but at school, so we were in between musics. You know, we were bicultural, bimusical too, because we had the Mexican music and then the American music. So it was a really first time we went to college and listened to music that we could keep listening to the American music, you know. But we also brought in our cumbias and our cha-cha-chas mm-hmm. and all that. So through Rudy, I think he was the first one because he used to serenade us at Hoover Hall where we were, the Chicano students were. I don't know where the guys were, but we were at Hoover Hall. And we'd sit around the fountain and sing. So whenever we had some downtime, we would sing and laugh. And so the Chicano movement, for me anyway, it was more like a familia. Because I didn't know anybody. I was from North First Street, obviously. I lived on a ranch all my life, so I didn't know anybody. Whereas Carl and some of the guys lived in my high school. They lived in real cool houses. You know, they had houses. We didn't. We lived in the rancho. So it was very different for me, the experiences. But so it was a thing that we could get together and talk to people that understood our language and understood where we sang, where we sat. Because sometimes, like, okay, I like Chubby Checker, but he's not Mexicano. That's okay, you can like him, you know. So we were kind of exploring our own desires, our own culture, and other cultures because we studied other cultures.
I'm glad you mentioned that because there is a lot of a common history with the Filipinos, especially here in California.
I'm glad you mentioned that. I grew up in Delano, and there's a sizable Filipino population there. And I remember when I worked in the fields in the summertime, one time we got invited out to one of the campos. You had all these elderly Filipinos because of the race laws couldn't find anybody to marry. So they lived out in the campo in a little group by themselves. And one time we got invited out there and we got to kill a pig. And I was like 14, 15 years old, and that was a lot of fun. But the Filipinos are a neglected chapter of the farm worker movement. They sacrifice so much, just like us. And I'm glad you mentioned that, because it is important to understand that the Filipinos are right there with us.
All right, we're going to listen to one more song and then come back on back to the do the interview. Because I did bring up some of the music from the period, and I want to give a shout out to Lupe Lujan Montes de Oca. She is a collector, a keeper of a lot of the music. In fact, she me prestó the Flor del Pueblo album, because mine has disappeared. And I know whoever's listening out there, you got to return it.
Bring it back.
Books too. Books too.
And also, we're going to listen to this one by Rumel Fuentes, and this is the song. The tune entitled Aslan, and that we'll be back to talk about what Aslan meant and means to many gente today. Orale.
Kids feeling good about themselves, kids staying out of the penal system, you know, kids being successful, kids being productive, and being a change agent, no matter what. We don't say that everybody has to go to college, because not all people go to college, but you can be successful in whatever field and be proud to be who you are. Because like I said earlier, some of us come from mixed cultures. You know, a Mexicano is a mixed culture. Come on, mm-hmm. It's a Mexicano and Espanol. And so we have very variations, and to be proud of who you are. And so at that time in history, for us in the 60s and 70s, it was very important to identify with our culture, to know about our culture, because we didn't know. I didn't know anyway. I don't know, maybe you did, but I didn't know. I knew I was from Mexico, and I went to Mexico. I was one of those kids they talked about, oh no, they're going to Mexico again for a month, they'll be gone. But what they didn't know is when we went to school, and we learned, and we became very fluent in our language, and we kept our language, because one of the things that was happening to all of our Chicano students, or Mexicano students, whatever you want to call us, we were losing our language. You know, you first dominated Spanish, then you went to school and dominated English, and then you became, you did like trochimochi Spanish. You didn't know all the words because you didn't practice it. You lose your language. And that's one of my fears, is that many students have lost the language. And, you know, the best time to learn it is when you're little, but you can always learn the language. And so one of my goals is to preserve our language and our culture, and to push kids forward, because we have to be those role models. In education, I tell my students, don't just be a teacher. It's okay to be a teacher. Be a director. Be a superintendent. You know, think big.
Yeah,
the sky's the limit.
I'm glad that you were either, you know, a worker, laborer, or a veteran, or mm-hmm. and there was not much in between. But that definitely has changed. But you have to keep on pushing it, because it's there's that also now that the judicial system that seems to trap a lot of the...
You know what's interesting? We say we've come a long way, and we have in some aspects, but in some aspects we have not. I mean, when you look at statistics and look at the number of Latinos in education, higher levels, I'm talking higher levels of education, the judicial system, and the law system, we're still pushing for that, because we've got to be there to make it happen. It's not going to happen automatically. You've got to fight, and you've got to stand your ground. And you can do it in a non-violent way. We've always preached it. Right.
I'm glad you said the nonviolent.
Nonviolence.
I'm glad you said that.
Pláticas, you know, pláticas. Mm-hmm. And my father, I've always said, if you don't like a particular race or group of people, befriend one. Learn their culture. Eat with them. Talk mm-hmm. to them. And you'll find out that we're all the same.
Yep.
We're just different. Our coding is different, but we're all, you know, the same on the inside. And so we're just people here trying to make our world better. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we learned, at least I learned, in the 60s, 70s, and even up to now, is to make the world a better place. Do your part. Don't just sit back. Do your part in instilling pride in your culture, no matter what it be, or your cultures, because many of us now have so many blended families. Be proud of who you are, where you came from, and where you're going. And so that we learned, I think, from the Chicano movement. You know, we wouldn't have gotten it. If you had gone to school before that, you never had Latino professors, women, especially women. Mm-hmm. I mean, women it just didn't happen, just like administrators. And you look now, at least I know from the field of education, there's some, but there's not that many in comparison. Mm-hmm. And so just keep going and dream big and don't stop, no matter what. And if you're a business owner, that's another thing we didn't talk about, but we're going to celebrate those. But there's many that went through our ELP program from the different universities, who maybe didn't finish school, and that's okay, but they became business owners. Mm-hmm. I mean, my own family, we have two businesses. And other people, right, Carl, that went on to do one like yourself.
Absolutely. It was much more than doing, shall we say, the glamorous majors, political science, stuff like that. It didn't matter what major you were in. There was different groups that in the different departments, whether it was business, you name it, psychology. And I think what happened as a result of the Chicano Student Movement, it was the flowering of our professional class. You didn't have teachers like everyone's talking about. You didn't have doctors, lawyers, social workers, you name it, newspaper reporters. The beginning of the movement created our own professional class. Out of that, we were able to get into electoral politics. We were able to elect our own mayor, Ron Gonzalez. We have four members of La Raza currently in the city council of San Jose, yet people don't talk about that. If you don't mind, I'd like to get back to the idea of what Atzlan symbolizes to me, because it's something very special to me. I also, like Irma said, I didn't know what that meant, and I came to understand that in my mind, it's a spiritual thing. It's not a geographical location. You go on this spiritual quest to see about what you are as a human being and how you fit into the society that we live in. So in that sense, Atzlan is a spiritual place. It's something where you can't put your finger on. It's a state of mind, I think, to be a Chicano. It lets you understand that to help your race, you have to do a little bit of self-sacrifice. And I think that's important to realize that.
Some bitter words, and I know that self-reflection, that there's also that indigenous bond that connects. The term to me also expands that known that from inception, from the food we eat, from the traditions and all that from our people, and that to me is the link. It's critical for the honoring of the ancestors. As we now today, they even have a movie now that's gotten even hueros into the
Coco.
you know what I was talking about. Yeah. I know.
And all the little kids want to do gritos now, which is fabulous.
Right, but that's what to me the word means. It's a celebration and returning to our indigenous roots and accepting them.
Yes, and you know what's really like to me when I speak to students and they're interested in, let's say, journalism, and I go, oh my gosh, we had Rigoberto Chacon, who was the first Bay Area news chief, and he mentored Damian Trujillo, and others. And so to me, that's so inspiring. And the thing about those two gentlemen is that, and others, they walk their talk, you know? Mm-hmm. They speak the language, both languages. They mentor people, and just like us, you know, we're willing to mentor anybody. I always tell people, if you're interested in education, see me, and I can do what I can do, because I really didn't have anybody to mentor me, but I mentored my brother who has a PhD, you know? So I think that's what we're all about also, is mentoring others who are interested, because we're all different, and we all specialize in different fields, but nonetheless, it's about respeto, you know, respecting cultures, not just our culture, but all cultures.
And I think, también, Irma, it's the palabra, our word. Mm-hmm. And just as you have been sharing your word, your feeling, but that bond, the connection, our word being our just our link, and also our walking the talk for our kids and others that follow, that we definitely want to lead by example. And it's challenging, because in this pluralistic and very materialistic society, to keep that keep the Chicanismo going, keeping the rebellion alive. And today, I think more than ever, we need to reconnect. You guys have a saying on the flyer, on the, what is about the little circle, about the past.
Connecting the past with the past.
Exactly.
Yeah, connections.
I think that is much more needed today than ever before.
Yeah, I think what the young who are listening to this, students or non-students, what they need to know is there's a whole generation 50 years ago that can actually mentor you in whatever field you choose to go to. And it doesn't have to be in the high, like into law or medical and all that stuff. But there's people out there that we know, because we know the people. We were part of that 400 group that can mentor you, and they can lead the way if you don't have anyone to lead you, because it's so much easier when someone's there to mentor you. And we know that, because now at the elementary schools, guess what? Even the kindergartners come to San Jose State to check out the campus, or Stanford, or whatever school. And we never had that opportunity. Nobody even mentioned that. We didn't even know what a university was, some of us, because, I mean, it was something that was not within our reach, or we didn't know. But now we know that todo se puede, as we say, and you can do it. You know, it may take you longer, but si se puede.
That's right.
Along the same lines, if I may make a comment about our the newly formed organization that I belong to, it's been around for roughly a year and a half now, La Raza Historical Society of Santa Clara Valley. We picked that name because we didn't want to feel anybody wouldn't be included in what we meant by La Raza. We wanted to make sure our brothers and sisters from Central and South America and the Caribbean felt that they were part of La Raza also. So that's how we got the name, and we've been in existence now for approximately a year and a half. We just recently were offered a house that we're going to take over. It'll be our headquarters at History Park, at Kelly Park. That'll be Casa de La Raza. So we're in the process of getting some funding for grants so we can fix up the house, and we're going to be having events now because we're now part of that group over there. So I just wanted to let people know that if you want, you can look for La Raza Historical Society on Facebook, and you'll see our page. We don't have a website yet, unfortunately, but we're working on that. So I just wanted to mention that.
I'd like to piggyback on that, Carl, because one of the things Ramon and I want to help with is we know there's people listening that have old cameras with you know, how they used to have the little, what do you call those?
Polaroids?
Yeah, the Polaroid or whatever,
yeah.
Film. And we want to... If people have that, we're asking people to share it with us, and we'll copy it and put it onto CDs so that we can show that at the Raza House, so that we preserve our own history, because nobody has it, but we have it. We have pictures.
You know, I'd like to say something about that, if I may, real quick. Excuse me, Irma. Being part of the group over there at the History Park, now we not just have that building for our headquarters, we can have events there. We also have access to digitizing the photos that Irma was talking about. Mm-hmm. So there's a wide range of things we're going to be able to do over there. And basically, our mission is basically to preserve and disseminate our culture, and especially the young people. I think personally, we need to really make the young people aware of our rich history and how Silicon Valley is much more than just high tech. I tell people that we have to remember the human technology, the people that work the fields, that work the assembly lines, and we're the janitors. They are the real foundation of Silicon Valley, and it's neglected.
All right, well, I want to really, again, express my profound appreciation for you, both of you, to take time to come and share this real important history, the Chicano movement, the Chicano community here, and also to share other information and encouragement, words of encouragement, Irma, especially in the near field. I think that is a real tribute to a true leader, is to keep the door, opening the door wider and wider for others to follow.
What we know is that's what we all have in college, in common. We all go to school. Hopefully, yeah. Everybody goes to school, right?
You go to get a chance, an opportunity.
Yes, you
an
have
opportunity.
An opportunity to go to school.
That's all you need.
That's where we got the captive audience, and so, you know, we can be the change agent. We are the change agent, and that's what I want to say to people. You know, don't stop there. Keep going and express your thoughts in the schools.
And so the event again is the 50th anniversary of the Chicano Student Movement at San Jose State. That's when the walkouts, which triggered in a broader community, the walkouts of the Chicano students during the San Jose State
Commencement.
And so that.
And that summer, 400 of us came out to campus, yes.
And so the event is Saturday, November 3rd, from 5 to 9 p.m. at the San Jose State University Student Union Ballroom, which is newer. I hear
yes,
that's
it's
not
beautiful.
The old one.
It's not the old one.
Not the old one. So, and for ticket information, you can go to where, Carl? Where can they go? Let's see, you can get your tickets at brownpapertickets.com.
Thank you
for being who you are now.
Absolutely.
It's a pleasure. Thank you very much. Yes, and we look forward to seeing everybody at our event, because it's a fabulous event to get to know history, to get to know the way it used to be and the way it is now, and it's just awesome.
And the way it needs to be again.
And I'm planning to attend. I got my wife's an alumni, actually a couple of my kids, Uncle Theo. There's a lot. We're spreading the word, so we may need half the building just for
That's cool.
We're gonna leave you right now with the Vietnam veterano and recognition of all the families that were impacted by the war, the movimiento, and also the let's just say the si se puede attitude that has moved our people forward today and beyond. So, Qui le va, Vietnam Veterano by Al Reyes.
Yeah, I'm always grateful for the chance I get to come on KKUP and talk about issues that affect our community, and today was a good example of that. I think we informed people about the history of our raza, And now they know about the reunion that's going to be coming up, and that's a way to preserve our history so that it remains alive. History speaks to us. We need to listen to the history so we can learn the lessons from the past to make our community better today and into the future.
And I'd like to say thank you so much for having this opportunity to get the word out. And it's always an honor to spread the word of the events that are going on in our community, but most importantly, to document what happened in the 60s as the Chicano movement was at its height point, and to document that. So that's what we're doing at the event. We'll be interviewing different people and taking statements so that we make sure that we represent everyone who's part of it, not just the students, okay? So hopefully you'll join us on November 3rd, this coming Saturday. We'll be opening doors at 4:30 and we'll be there till 9. So que viva la raza, and we hope to see you there. Thank you. Gracias. De nada.